Hello everyone, I'm Zia Ahmed and today I'm here with a special and informative session on sleep apnea. A good quality sleep is one among basic needs of every human being. But do we check regularly that are we getting a good quality sleep, a proper sleep? Have you ever noticed that sometimes you feel tired even after having a good 7 to 8 hours sleep? Do you find yourself napping during times when you would prefer to be awake? Do you feel drowsy when you need to be alert? For talking on these, I have requested my friend Ahmad Danyal to join me here and enlighten us. Ahmad Danyal has an extensive experience in this line. Thanks, Danyal, for joining me here. How are you?
I'm good, thank you. My pleasure.
So, Danyal, if I just want to know from how long you are working in this line?
So, I am a registered polysomnographic technologist, or in common words known as a sleep technician. I'm registered by the Board of Registered Polysomnographic Technologists in America, and I practice here in Maryland. I've been working for about 2 years now, and I was working as an intern for about a year before that in a hospital.
Okay, thanks. Okay, Danyal, if I want to know how we can identify the initial signs of a sleep disorder or sleep apnea.
Sure. The first thing is, if you share your bed with someone, they sometimes may notice that you're having pauses in breath, or that maybe your snoring is extremely severe. Usually the cases that we get with patients is that their spouses complain that, I know for a fact that my spouse is not getting good quality sleep. First thing is the evidence of a spouse or a person who's taking care of someone and who knows for a fact that the person may be having some signs of trouble sleeping. But for people who live alone, or for people who are kind of on the edge or who aren't certain, there are other indications that you can see. We have different kinds of questionnaires for that as well. But mostly what is asked of patients is, do you feel drowsy during the day? There is a questionnaire called the Berlin questionnaire and other sleep apnea questionnaires that have specific scenarios where they ask patients, do you fall asleep in school, at work? Do you feel like you definitely have to take a nap, otherwise you can't survive the day? Very dangerous and very important is, do you feel drowsy when you're driving? That's a big one. Do you fall asleep at a traffic light? Are you ever able to complete a full movie or a TV show, or do you always fall asleep? Do you always fall asleep reading a book? So most people, if they have trouble sleeping, they're likely to fall asleep during the day, especially when they would like to stay awake. That's true for students or employees or anyone. The other thing is other medical signs, like maybe headaches, or a big thing with people who don't have good quality sleep is usually they are overweight, which is why they're also prone to having sleep apnea, because weight is the most directly linked with having this issue. And the other thing is they are irritable, or they have trouble concentrating, and they're prone to headaches, or they use a lot of caffeine and stimulants. So you kind of have to go off several things. But if you have the signs present, then what usually people do is that they will go to their primary care physician or doctor. They will tell them about their trouble with sleep, or always having a headache, or not feeling like they're always tired. Physically, because when you're not sleeping well, then your body's not getting, your muscles are not getting the rest that they need. So you're feeling tired all the time. You're having difficulty getting into exercise or just walking. And then that doctor usually refers them to a sleep lab for getting a baseline sleep study done, which is also called a PSG.
Yani, bottom line, you have highlighted that with improper sleep, our body does not get the needed rest.
Yes.
That you want to highlight.
Yes, so with improper sleep, first of all, your life expectancy is lowered significantly. Now, I mean, we consider that pretty normal. If you were meant to live till 70 and you live till 60, you might still be content with that. But if you have good quality sleep, you will definitely live longer, other medical conditions notwithstanding. Because, of course, sleep apnea on its own is one thing, but for most people, they also have other, what we call in the medical field, comorbidities. Hypertension is a big one, diabetes, other respiratory problems, which may cause them to use oxygen or other things because when you're sleeping, your muscles, they become more relaxed. Mm-hmm. And when you're active, you may breathe okay, but when you're sleeping, you may not have the muscle power, or your lungs may not have the energy needed to breathe normally, which can cause sleep apnea. So different things, you know. It's difficult to pinpoint one thing, but there are definitely signs.
Okay. Daniel, what factors trigger it and then later on increase sleep apnea or sleep disorder?
So there could be genetic factors as well. We learned in school, actually, that in certain ethnicities, sleep apnea is more prevalent, especially when people have, you know, like a larger nose, mm-hmm. or a certain sort of a jaw structure. Yes, they could have other, you know, congenital anatomical features that encourage sleep mm-hmm. apnea. Because basic sleep apnea, what we call, there are different types of sleep apnea, but the most common one is called obstructive sleep apnea. What obstructive sleep apnea is that when you're sleeping, especially on your back, because if whether or not you've noticed, most people, especially in their adult life, they don't sleep on their back.
Yeah.
Feel like their heart is sinking or they're choking.
Yeah, so yeah.
Adults, they either sleep on their sides or they completely turn over, especially if they're overweight and they
on
sleep
the belly.
Because that's the only way they can breathe. But basically what these structures do is that when you're sleeping, especially on your back, and sometimes if it's severe also in other positions, your passageway collapses upon itself. So it creates a blockage. Now, if it's a complete blockage, it's a complete obstructive apnea. If it's a partial blockage, which is much more common in all cultures, it's called snoring. So strictly speaking, you shouldn't even be snoring, even though snoring is much more socially acceptable around the world.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
Strictly speaking, you shouldn't even be snoring when you're sleeping.
Okay. Okay, Daniel, I just want to know, can we cure sleep apnea or we can just maintain it?
So because it's not a disease or an infection that needs like antibiotics or a cure, it's a physiological sort of a disease. So it can be cured by making lifestyle changes. In certain cases, maybe certain medications will help as well, because certain medications, they suppress your respiration when you're sleeping. So that's something to discuss with the doctor. In most cases, it's because of extra weight. Usually, and in my personal experience as well, cardio exercise, a little bit of jogging, brisk walk, anything that elevates your heart rate, causes you to sweat, causes you to be more fit, that will definitely help you sleep. I would say that's the weight loss and exercise is probably the best non-medical and non-expensive intervention or cure, if you will, that you can provide for sleep apnea.
The walking or jogging, what time you prefer? What time we do and we can get best results as far as sleep apnea or sleep disorder is concerned?
So the time of the day doesn't really matter, as long as you're doing it regularly. And you know what they say about exercise is, you know, just fit it in whenever you can. Like as a sleep technician, I work overnight, which means that I'm awake all night and asleep during the day. So when I exercise, I sometimes go out at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. It's a little cold outside right now, and I don't prefer going to the gym, although there are 24-hour gyms all over the place.
Yep.
But, you know, just fit it in whenever you can. There doesn't have to be a specific time for it. If there's anything that needs a specific time, it's your sleep time.
Okay.
As far as your work is concerned, first of all, we're not supposed to stay up all night. As humans, you know, certain animals, they are naturally able to stay up all night, like cheetahs or owls.
Yeah, they're nocturnal in habit. Yeah.
Yes, nocturnal creatures who hunt during the night.
Yes.
They are meant to stay up overnight.
Yes.
As humans, we're not meant to stay overnight. When the sun goes down, our brain creates a chemical called melatonin, which is also available as a sleep aid over the counter. So our brain creates melatonin, which induces our body to want to fall asleep. So that's something natural in us. The best thing to do is to go to bed at night and wake up in the morning, because our life cycle rotates around the sun. When the sun goes down, we should sleep. When the sun comes up, we should be active. But even for whatever reason, if you can't sleep during the night, like me, I work overnight, so I sleep during the day. The best thing to do is to have a fixed sleep. Because if you are awake nights for certain days of the week, and then you have to be awake during the day, when you, what we call rotating shifts, if you're working rotating shifts, that's the worst thing for sleep, because there is an internal clock in our brain. So it doesn't matter when you go to sleep, as long as you go to sleep on a regular time, your brain can somehow get used to it. But if you deprive even that timetable, your brain off that timetable, and you're sleeping all over the place, your sleep quality will be pretty bad.
Good, good, okay. Thanks for that. Okay, just I want to know very briefly that sometimes people say that, oh, if there is such a problem, use tranquilizers. But what I want to know, does tranquilizer help us in curing this or maintaining this sleep apnea?
Well, you would need to know what they're taking the tranquilizers for. I don't think tranquilizers are prescribed for sleep apnea. If anything, they would be prescribed for, I'm not a doctor, keep in mind, but if anything, they would be prescribed for muscle restlessness, which would probably disturb your sleep. But on the same hand, depending on the type of tranquilizer, it can also suppress your respiration, which can worsen your sleep apnea. Uh-huh. So it really depends on the patient. It's a case-by-case basis sort of a thing.
Okay. Yeah, thanks for that. Okay, just I want to know what happens step by step if sleep apnea or sleep disorder is not treated. What happens if it remains untreated, and what happens step by step to us then?
You're going to keep gaining weight. You're going to continue to have bad quality sleep, which means that your general life will be miserable. You'll always be tired. You'll always be irritable. You will have trouble focusing on things. And slowly and gradually, you will catch on to muscle disorders relatively quickly. Depends on your genetics as well and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. It really depends, but it does take years off your life. You're just in your daily life, you're not as happy.
Bottom line is, we can say that our quality of our life will go down instead of increasing.
Well, your quality of life is already affected when you have sleep apnea, but if you don't treat it, it's going to keep going down. So, yeah, that's pretty much what's going to happen.
Okay.
Yeah. The reason people treat it is just to have a good daily life.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Danyal. You gave us a very good insight about this. And I hope we will have another session soon to explore it further. So I request my viewers that if you have any questions in this, you can send us and we can take the questions, and then we can do another session based on the questions. So are you ready for another session, Danyal?
Oh, absolutely. Anytime.
Thank you very much for your this. And I hope to see you again. Thank you. Have a good day.
Thank you.
Bye.